introduce our speaker for the night. There he is. Timothy Billings is a professor of English and American Literatures and an active member of the Comparative Literature Program at Middlebury College, where he's been teaching courses on Shakespeare, early modern literature, literary theory, and translation for over 15 years. He has received multiple fellowships from the National Endowment for the Humanities, the Folger Shakespeare Library, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Zhangjing Guo Foundation, among others. He has led several advanced research seminars and workshops at the meetings of Shakespeare Association of America on topics ranging from Shakespeare in translation to Shakespeare in the 21st century classroom. In addition to high-profile articles in the Shakespeare Quarterly and Representations, his books include translations and critical editions of Matteo Ricci's On Friendship, 100 Maxims for a Chinese Prince, as well as Victor Segalin's French and Chinese Poetry, Stellus, which was awarded the Modern Language Association's Book Award for the Best Literary Translation, and his new critical edition of Ezra Pound's first collection of Chinese translations, Cathay, is forthcoming in the fall of 2016. He is currently editing and annotating Love's Labor's Lost for the Internet Shakespeare edition. So please join me in welcoming Professor Timothy Billings.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much, Wendy. It's so delightful to see so many of you here ready to spend an hour thinking about Shakespeare. It warms my heart a great deal on this warm early January evening. It's hard for me, you can imagine, it's hard for me to think of how I can do an introduction to Shakespeare, since I normally have 3 hours a week over a 12-week semester, so I normally have 36 hours to do this, and it's hard for me to imagine putting it all into 45 minutes. And so I've decided what I'm going to do is just tell you what I think are the 5 really important things to know about Shakespeare, the 5 sort of valuable insights that I feel I've come to as someone who's been reading the plays, seeing productions, and watching films for decades now, ever since I fell in love with Shakespeare at a very early age. So I'm going to read you what the 5 things are, and you know, I've said 5, it kind of makes, it seems like a tidy number. It's a little more than 3, fewer than 10, and I have a bunch of other little things I'm going to smuggle in along the way. And I've given you this picture here mostly so that it will begin to transform as a kind of an optical illusion in your minds, I'm hoping. It's a very familiar image to you, I'm sure you've all seen it many, many times before, but I'm hoping that as you continue to look at it for an hour, it may begin to change a little bit in your vision. We'll see how that works out. So these are the 5 things that I've come to realize are really important to me in thinking about Shakespeare. Number 1, it's really hard to see through our preconceptions of Shakespeare to get to the facts. In many ways, I feel as though all I'm doing in my courses is trying to get students to work through their preconceptions, or at least to be aware of their preconceptions in reading Shakespeare. Because students always come to my classes with quite a bit of knowledge about Shakespeare. And they've all read Shakespeare in high school. In many cases, they've read Shakespeare even in middle school. And they have a lot of knowledge about it. In fact, it's a bit unusual for them to take a course about something they know so much about already and feel so confident about. And yet, when I begin to poll them about what plays they've read, they tend to have read more or less two or three or four plays at most, and they're always the same plays. It's Romeo and Juliet, everyone's read Romeo and Juliet, maybe Julius Caesar, Hamlet, and then it's a bit of a grab bag after that, but it's usually 3 or 4 plays. And if we think that Shakespeare wrote about 40 plays, and the students have also not read either of the 2 long narrative poems, or any of the 154 sonnets. In fact, students come to class with a very confident sense of what they know about Shakespeare, even though they've read maybe 10 or 15% of Shakespeare's works. And so what they're doing is they're forming their preconceptions on a very, very small sliver of plays, which in fact also are plays that are very similar. They tend to be, Macbeth is often in there, right? Plays that are kind of similar in some way. Whereas if you begin to step outside of that and read plays like Two Gentlemen of Verona, plays that are not read very often, Two Noble Kinsmen. These are plays I like to teach because they really change the way we think about Shakespeare. Troilus and Cressida. Even Measure for Measure, a pretty popular play that does get performed, but also which really changes the way you think about Shakespeare. And suddenly a new picture begins to emerge. We know so much from popular culture that we have a great deal of confidence about Shakespeare. In fact, for the most part, we haven't gone through our preconceptions to go back to the text and read them carefully and form our own conclusions. So it's a hard thing to do, and it's one of the big challenges that I have with my students and we're continually doing. I sometimes begin class with a joke. It's not a very funny joke, but it makes a point. It usually takes the form of a little old lady joke. That's the problem with it to begin with. A little old lady, the book A Little Old Lady, or a very old farmer, has been a farmer his whole life, you know, maybe 80 years old or something, 90 years old, goes to see a Shakespeare play for the first time. His grandkids take him. He's never seen any Shakespeare before. They go to see a production of Hamlet. And afterward, she says, "I don't know what the fuss about this Shakespeare character is all about." He says, "To be or not to be, never a borrower nor a lender be, to be hoisted by your own petard, it's all just quotations." Right? Now you can see, I mean, my experience is that farmers, at least in Vermont, or little old ladies, at least in Vermont, are a lot cleverer than that. I don't think they're likely to make a mistake like that. But you understand the point, right? It tips, it hinges on our understanding that you don't need to be a scholar of Shakespeare to have learned a lot from Shakespeare, because his language has permeated the language that we use. And so I'm going to come back to this a little bit. Of course, I just want to introduce these topics, and I'll say just a few more things about this. The second point that I'm going to talk about today is that one of my great insights is that Shakespeare is intensely aware, artistically aware, of his medium, or of his media. Considered as medium. One medium is the theater, and another medium is poetry. Shakespeare, we often ask ourselves, or sometimes people ask me, or sometimes we just sort of raise the question, what would Shakespeare be like? What would Shakespeare think if he were alive today? And what kind of writer would he be if he were alive today? What kind of playwright would he be if he were alive today? Would he even be writing plays? I mean, Is the theater the equivalent in our modern day culture of the theater in Elizabethan and Jacobean England? I don't think so. I mean, it's very likely that if Shakespeare were alive today, he would be writing. He would be a screenwriter, or more likely, it seems to me, a script writer for these sort of the new long series dramas. You know, like The Sopranos or something like that. You know, where it's sort of this really kind of edgy, dynamic writing is going on now, which, you know, just like the theater in Shakespeare's day, is something for television that for the most part we didn't take seriously. None of us really took very seriously, say, 10 or 20 years ago, but which we're now beginning to recognize is a medium, right, is an art form. And so, you know, he might be actually a television writer now. Wow, that's kind of shocking to consider. And I think if we ask ourselves these questions, it helps us kind of dislodge our preconceptions. So I want to spend a little bit of time talking about how Shakespeare is artistically aware of his medium. So it's hard for us to see through our preconceptions to get to the facts. Shakespeare is artistically aware of his medium. Three, every generation creates Shakespeare in its own image. This is a huge insight. The Shakespeare that in fact is formed through our preconceptions is the image that we're creating of Shakespeare for ourselves. You can see that all of these insights are related in some way. In some sense, they all have to do with how Shakespeare has changed over time and how Shakespeare is continually changing. So I'm going to give you some examples of that. The next one is five, or I guess it's four, that we must seek Shakespeare both in adaptation and also by returning to the quote-unquote originals. We must seek Shakespeare both through adaptations and by returning to the quote-unquote originals. This is really the big issue, the big thing I'm going to be talking about today. And I say quote-unquote originals because we don't really have Shakespeare's originals. We don't have Shakespeare's manuscripts. And the printed versions of the plays that we have are at a couple levels of remove from his hand, although there's been a lot of good scholarly bibliographic detective work done on them. Actually, we have one manuscript, a collaborative manuscript that has a passage in it that scholars are pretty confident was written by Shakespeare, but one little piece, and it's none of the plays of the full plays that we know. And then the last thing is really an extension of this this idea of adaptation and originals, is that most of what we think of as Shakespeare is not. You can see this is also very closely related. Most of what we think of as Shakespeare is not. That is to say, the Shakespeare that we've created in our own image is not really Shakespeare. What most people have known as Shakespeare is not really Shakespeare. It's some level of remove from that. And I'll explain further what I mean as I go through the examples. But one of the things I'm going to do, and this is where I'll actually talk about a few details, is that it's safe to say that Shakespeare is perhaps not the greatest writer who has ever lived in world history. That would be an impossible thing to determine because we have to know what our criteria are. And you say someone who writes plays might not even be eligible for that role. But it's certainly safe to say that Shakespeare is the best known and most widely read author in English history, or in world history, I think, you know, with the exception of perhaps some classic writers. And yet, by most of the people in the world, I mean, Shakespeare truly is a global phenomenon. He's read not in English, but in translation. And so what most people are reading when they read Shakespeare is also, it's not really Shakespeare in a sense. They're reading translations of Shakespeare. And I want to spend a minute talking about that. As you heard from the introduction, translation is something that I spend a lot of time thinking about. And so I want to spend a little time on that. So go back to the first point now. When I say it's hard to get through the preconceptions to get to the facts, part of the problem is that it's hard just to know what the facts are. One of the questions that's often asked of me is it true that Shakespeare had a bigger vocabulary than any other writer who's ever lived? Is it true that Shakespeare invented more words in English than any writer who's ever lived? And it's a very hard question to answer. In fact, there is an article that was just published about 5 years ago by a scholar named Hugh Craig, does a very, very good job of starting to answer this question. But if you go online and I Google that question, you know, how big was Shakespeare's vocabulary? The first thing that will pop up on Google is ShakespeareOnline.com, which will confidently tell you, just a commercial site, will confidently tell you that Shakespeare has an amazing vocabulary of 24,000 discrete words, which is significantly higher than any other writer, and also the only great writer who comes close to it in the period is John Milton, who has a vocabulary of, I think they say, 16,000 words. They list the source as James Davy Butler, but what they don't tell you is that that source was published in 1888. Now, this, I think this gets repeated in many other places. Now, this is the kind of question that you really can't answer until you have textual databases that can be processed by computers and analyzed with statistics. It's a very, very hard problem to frame and question to answer. James Davy Butler can't be blamed that. Well, I mean, think about this. James Joyce himself in Ulysses alone has 30,000 different words, right, in just that one novel. Now, admittedly, you know, that was written after James Davies had written this thing in 1888, and you know, you can't blame James Butler for doing that, but Ulysses had certainly been written by the time that the authors of the ShakespeareOnline.com posting was made. And why didn't they check that? In fact, even more egregious is that Stephen Greenblatt, probably the best known living Shakespeare scholar, so a great scholar, Shakespeare scholar at Harvard, says the same thing in the introduction to the Norton Anthology of Shakespeare, which came out with its new edition just this year. You can go buy your exorbitantly priced copy, textbook copy, for $90 or $100 or something. And it says exactly the same thing, which has been repeated from its first writing in 1997, but hasn't been revised, even though it was 5 years after Hugh Craig published this article, demonstrating that, in fact, Shakespeare, if you compare him to other playwrights of the period, falls in the middle. He has a very big vocabulary. But in fact, he falls in the middle of the unique uses of words. There are about the dozen greatest writers. There are about six who are ahead of him: Johnson, Dekker, Middleton, Haywood, Green, I think, and then half a dozen who fall below him. It's true that as if you count the actual number of the words, that his he has a vocabulary of about 20,000 words, according to Hugh Craig, and that the next closest person is Johnson, Ben Johnson, with 18,500 words. But the thing is, the sample size is different. We have only 17 of Johnson's plays, where we have 40 of Shakespeare's plays. And since each play adds more new words to the vocabulary, if you realize that Johnson has almost as many words, 18,500 compared to Shakespeare's 20,000, in half as many plays, then he has almost twice the density of unique words that Shakespeare does. And if we had all of Ben Johnson's plays, or as many as Shakespeare had, then we could conclude that Johnson has a sort of energy of using new words that's twice as great as Shakespeare's. And in fact, it's the effect you feel when you're reading Johnson. I mean, it's just extraordinary wordsmith. I mean, the power of the language is extraordinary. And also, when it comes to new words, it's also a very, very hard question to answer. You'll find lots of answers on the internet. But what does it mean to have invented a word for the language? The thing to look at here is that all playwrights in the period are inventing words. All writers in the period are inventing words at an astonishing rate. They're borrowing words from Latin. They're borrowing words from Italian and French. They're inventing new words. There's this kind of they're turning words into new words by changing the grammatical roles of speech they have. It's a really dynamic time. And in fact, we don't know, but I think it's pretty clear that Johnson invented more words than Shakespeare invented, that other playwrights actually invented more unique words. Again, a close statistical study would need to be done. But since we read Shakespeare, since Shakespeare has become a part of our educational system, those are the plays that we read over and over and over again. Those are the forms of speech. Those are the new words that we've adopted. Whereas since we don't read Johnson's plays or Middleton's plays over and over again, we've never had a chance to adopt that language. You see what I'm saying? So the way you ask the question actually changes your notion of what it is. There's more to say about that, but I'll leave it there. We can always come back to that if you're more interested in it. So the next big insight, as I said, is Shakespeare's keenly aware artistically of his media. I hear music. When my students don't turn off their cell phones, I always do a little dance until the music stops. Okay, now I can stop. All right, did my dance. If anybody else has a more upbeat ringtone, I would welcome that. This can really show off my moves. So when we ask him, whether Shakespeare would be a different kind of writer if he were not living in his time, working in the period, one of the things we're doing is imagining the plays as something other than plays. We're imagining the creative energy as being expressed in some way other than what a playwright does for the theater. And one of the things that a playwright does necessarily for the theater is collaborate. In fact, Shakespeare is a little bit unusual in this period, since most of Shakespeare's plays are written by himself alone. There are, I don't know, half a dozen plays that have signs of collaboration in them. So a very small percentage, whereas most of the plays seem to have written by himself. Whereas the common thing, the sort of the standard in the period is to write plays in collaboration with each other. And in a profound sense, theater is a collaborative medium. I mean, what Shakespeare does, what is write a kind of plan for the play. I like to think of the actual play, the actual original play, not as, say, the lost manuscript that we don't have because it got printed by, some guys in a printing house and then came down to us and kind of mucked up a little bit in the process, but rather as a living thing embodied by real people over time. When Shakespeare designed a play, what he was doing was designing something that would be alive stage, embodied by actors whom he knew. I mean, when he was writing roles, he knew the names and the characters and the strengths and weaknesses of the actors he was writing for. In fact, in one case, we have an example, a memorable case in one of the printed texts of Romeo and Juliet, which was obviously made from a manuscript. He says, instead of writing, "Enter Peter," the name of the character, a minor character. He says, enter Kemp. And Kemp is the name, William Kemp is the name of the comic actor who was performing that role. So in that case, what you see is Shakespeare imagining, oh, this is where I'm going to bring Kemp on stage to do a little comic shtick. He's not even thinking of the character. He's thinking of the actor and what the actor is going to do, right? So it's really hard for us to start thinking of the stories as separated from the theater itself. So I want to give you some examples of ways where Shakespeare is aware of the theater and where he plays with our knowledge that it's a theater. But let me give you a couple of the famous examples first. The most famous of them, of course, is All the World's a Stage. And Shakespeare, as someone who is intensely aware of the theater, employs the metaphor of the theater for life in a way that seems particularly rich, and which wouldn't be so, or which perhaps would be a different kind of metaphor if he weren't working in the theater. All the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances, and one man in his time plays many parts, his acts being seven ages. At first the infant, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. And then the whining schoolboy with satchel and shining morning face, creeping like snail unwillingly to school. And then the lover, sighing like furnace, with a woeful ballad made to his mistress' eyebrow. And then the soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like a pard, jealous in honor, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation. And the justice, in fair round belly with good capon lined, with eyes severe and beard of formal cut, full of wise saws and modern instances, and so he plays his part. The sixth age shifts into the lean and slippered pantaloon, with spectacles on nose and pouch on side, his youthful hose well saved, a world too wide for his shrunk shank. And his big manly voice turning again towards childish treble, pipes and whistles in sound. The last scene of all that ends this strange, eventful history is second childishness and mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything. Now I say the sans there, probably the way it was anglicized on the Elizabethan stage. And also, because the character who says this, Jaques, is extremely pretentious, and Shakespeare uses sans in both this play and in other plays as a sign of what pretentious characters say. Oh, sans. Well, shall we go out this evening sans jackets because it's so warm? You know, it's like, if you were to say that, right, you get the function. This was the case. It was a Frenchified borrowing. So sans. So at the very moment that he's kind of creating the sublime ending, he's also making fun of the character who's doing this. And Shakespeare's interesting in this way. He does a lot of things that are right on the edge of sentimental. And then he makes some disarming move like that. He makes this kind of laugh right at this moment where he's also kind of bringing the point home, which I have no better way to describe but sort of disarming you from criticism. By criticizing himself, he allows us to be taken. Consider this. So this is a sonnet that is aware of itself as a sonnet. This is a sonnet that says, all those other poets out there who are making false comparisons about their girlfriends or their boyfriends, comparing their eyes to stars, etc., etc. I would not do that. That's right. This is sonnet 130. My mistress's eyes are nothing like the sun. Coral is far more red than her lips red. If snow be white, why then her breasts are dun. If hairs be wires, black wires grow on her head. I have seen roses damasked red and white, but no such roses see I in her cheeks. And in some perfumes is there more delight than in the breath that from my mistress reeks. I love to hear her speak, yet well I know that music hath a far more pleasing sound. I grant I never saw a goddess go, my mistress, when she walks, treads on the ground. And yet, by heaven, It's a great sonnet. What I love about this is that it very disarmingly kind of has its cake and eats it too, right? It sort of says, this sort of writing poems about with all these comparisons doesn't work, and yet he manages to kind of create this sort of anti-poetical poetry that just is this magnificent. It's fully aware of itself as a poem at every line, but makes it, in fact, more sincere for being a poetical act instead of less sincere. You know, it's quite remarkable. There are also a couple of moments. You know, I like to read, as I mentioned, I like to read some of the early plays of William Shakespeare and some unusual plays with my students. Early plays like Two Gentlemen of Verona, partly because Two Gentlemen of Verona is just a terrible play. I mean, it's just an awful play. And it's really helpful and instructive to see a playwright at the very beginning of his career write a play that has some really marvelous moments in it. It has a really kind of daring, experimental quality to it, but which also is just kind of a mess. And it also the text is quite messy, so that's another question. It seems as though there are parts of the manuscript put together, there are inconsistencies that suggest that it wasn't, the version we have wasn't the best or finished manuscript. Love's Labour's Lost, for example, I mean, this is a spoiler, there's a spoiler here. The genius of Love's Labour's Lost is that it's a very, very conventional comic love scenario where the four men of Navarre are wooing the four, including the king, and are wooing the four ladies of France, including the princess of France, who becomes the queen of France at the end. And when news arrives that the princess's father, the king of France, has just died, suddenly this pall of death falls over the joyous celebrations. And the French women say, the French princess now, the queen says, you know, we have to leave now, we have to go back home. And the king of Navarre and his men sort of say, no, but wait, we're in love, and we're proposing to you now. Can you just say yes before you go, and then you know that will be a happy ending. And the princess has this wonderful line. I think it's one of it's an unassuming, but one of the most beautiful lines in Shakespeare. He says, "A time methinks too short to make a world without end bargain in." Right? It's like, okay, yeah, we've done all this wooing, but no, this is serious. Let's just wait on this. And so they say. They give them tasks and say, you guys need to go do different things for a year and come back and ask us again after a year, after we've done our mourning rites. And if you still want us then, and this isn't just, you know, your crush and your lust, then we'll talk about it then. It's a remarkable thing because everything in the play is moving towards this trajectory of the happy ending. And then Shakespeare says, bang, and he just crashes it down at the end and says, no, this is not going to happen that way. This is not how real love works. And Berun, the kind of charismatic character in the play, turns to the king and he says, our wooing doth not end like an old play. Jack hath not Jill. These ladies' courtesy might well have made our sport a comedy. And the king says, come, sir, it wants a 12-month and a day. And then it will end. And Berun says, but that's too long for a play. And it makes a wonderful joke because it's working in there, but it's also, it seemed to me, you know, intimately connected to this idea that, you know, if you want to show the beginnings of love, you have to show only just the beginnings because every other comic ending is a false contrivance. And the only way to show the beginning of a real love is not to show it. Right? It's to let it fail and then leave you wondering whether it's actually going to fulfill itself in the way that it should. I think it's quite marvelous. There's another way in which Shakespeare is very aware of his medium with this kind of experimental play that he does. In Two Gentlemen of Verona, again, possibly Shakespeare's earliest plays, there's this moment where Valentine, who's in love with Sylvia, and it's got his abject suitor, they'll do anything you say, Sylvia says, write me some love verses, which I want to send to another suitor. And he's like, oh God, I can't believe I have to do this. Because, okay, I'll do anything for you. So he writes these love poems, and he gives them to her, and she says, no, these are pretty good. Take them for your pains. And he's like, well, but wait a minute, are they not good enough? it was hard for me to do, painful, but I'll do it again. And she says, no, it's, oh, was it really that hard for you? And he's like, no, it wasn't that hard. You know, he's just doing, he's saying everything he can. He says, oh, take him. And the whole time Speed is there. Speed, his clever servant, says, this is so clever. She had him write a love letter to himself for her, so she didn't actually have to write the love poem. And therefore kind of tipping her hand to show, oh, yeah, I am really in love with you. But Valentine, he's sort of the good-looking, dumb type, he's too doltish to figure out that she's giving him love verses. They're the love verses that he wrote. And so while they're playing this out, Speed's steps down to the audience and has this aside. He says, oh, jest unseen, inscrutable, invisible, as a nose on a man's face or a weathercock on a steeple. Actually, invisible and steeple are supposed to rhyme there, so I guess it's sort of like invisible and on a steeple. Oh, jest unseen, inscrutable, invisible, as a nose on a man's face, or a weathercock on a steeple. Oh, and then he has another line here, then another couplet. Then he says, oh, excellent device. Was there ever heard of better that my master, being scribe to himself, should write the letter? And Valentine says, how now, sir? What, are you reasoning with yourself? And he says, nay, I was rhyming. It is you that have the reason. Right, so if you're reading this, it's like, okay, this is kind of funny. But think about this, right? You have an audience, an actor who comes down and starts saying, oh my God, was there ever a better device than this? And we understand that there are rules of the theater, right? Which is someone who is projecting his voice to the back of the theater cannot be heard by someone standing right next to him if he's making an aside, right? So he says this great clever thing, and somehow Valentine overhears him. He says, what's the line? He says, how now, sir? What, are you reasoning with yourself? What, how do you? He says, no, I'm talking to all of those people right down there. Right? It's a very odd thing to break the illusion there, to play with the medium. And it must have been funny. It must have been one of those things that has this almost postmodern quality to it. And in fact, I think that when we consider the question of how we approach the difficulties of approaching Shakespeare, and how each generation, each age has recreated Shakespeare in its own image, I think that we are now at a period where we are better able to appreciate many of the effects of Shakespeare like this than the Restoration period was, than the 18th century was, than the Victorian period was. Even then, perhaps it's starting to happen in the modernist period, the early 20th century, because postmodernism is very comfortable with this kind of breaking of the rules and these kinds of disjunctions. It's very common for us to have this kind of high and low, comic and tragic mixed together. And it's how Shakespeare's plays work. And yet what's funny is that when they're read in a similar way, when the plays get produced, what happens is playwrights and film directors do this too. They cut out often they'll cut out all the comic parts in a history that balances this sort of tragical historical with comical parts, because their sense is that the comic parts don't fit with the seriousness of the rest of the play. The comic parts don't fit with the seriousness of the tragedy. And when we're reading, we do something similar, although it's subliminal, and this is where we have to overcome our preconceptions. We read a comic scene we've never seen in a movie before, that we've never seen in a stage production because it's always cut. And so we also just kind of quickly read over it and we go on to the next thing. But what we don't realize is that that scene is there because Shakespeare thought that for this to be the best play it could be, that scene needed to be there. So there's a kind of structural logic, or a logic, say, demanded by what an audience wants from the actors. That scene is there because I want Will Kemp to come out on stage and do a comic shtick, and so does the audience. It also allows us to move from this part of the plot to this part of the plot. You see what I'm saying? So that, in that sense, Shakespeare's awareness of the medium and the way he constructs his plays so clearly together with the medium is really important. There's another scene at the end of Cleopatra which I think is extraordinary, which really highlights this moment, or this dynamic. At the very end of the play, see, Cleopatra's about to kill herself with a poisonous asp, right? She sets it to her breast and bites her and she dies of the poison. And she's there preparing for the suicide, and she's talking to her handmaid, and she laments a future in which Cleopatra herself will be mocked by actors on a stage. It's this weird, this kind of self-reflexive moment, right? She says, the quick comedians, and comedians here mean just actors, it doesn't have the comic sense, or just the quick comedians extemporally will stage us and present our Alexandrian revels. Antony shall be brought drunken forth, and I shall see some squeaking Cleopatra boy my greatness in the posture of a whore. What a bizarre, wild thing to do. And also to use this word, some squeaking Cleopatra boy my greatness in the posture of a whore. What she's saying is that in some boy will squeak out Cleopatra, the role of Cleopatra, in the character of a whore, right? But instead of saying some boy will squeak it out, she says some squeaking Cleopatra will boy my greatness. So what does boy mean here? I mean, if you look up boy in the Oxford English Dictionary, actually I'm not sure. Sure, but it might actually be there as a definition. But it's the only usage with this meaning that anyone has ever done. It's a genuinely deep meaning. Shakespeare invented this use of the word. So he takes a noun and turns it into a verb. And the verb means something like to perform, as a boy actor, to perform the role of, to perform a role, something like that, to boy my greatness. And also perhaps with some sense of to kind of mar it because it's a boy who's squeaking out the role instead of a proper actor, or proper, perhaps an imaginary proper female actor. I mean, one of the things I'm sure you all know is that there are no women on Shakespeare's stage, right? All of the actors are male. So the male parts, or the men, are all played by men, and all the women's parts are played by boys from around, who knows, from maybe 7 to 17 years old, something like that. So It's sometimes what people call to think of it in sort of modern terms as a transvestite theater. That sounds really racy, doesn't it? A transvestite theater, because you have all these boys dressed as women playing these roles. So here at this moment, Shakespeare is having Cleopatra right before her grand scene say, someday on the stage, I'm going to have some squeaking Cleopatra boy my greatness in the posture of a whore. Now, I mean, it's kind of stunning to think suddenly, if in fact we've been swept up by the illusion and we've been thinking of this probably very, very accomplished young actor impersonating a woman, probably a lot of the time with exquisite precision to the point where it's really hard not to see the illusion of the woman there. Why would you draw attention to it at this moment? Why would you kind of sabotage the illusion? Well, I mean, I think you do it partly because you know the actor, the boy actor, is really damn good, and he can pull that off, right? You don't draw attention to yourself as a squeaking actor boying Cleopatra unless you're not doing that. And yet what it does is it draws our attention to the extraordinary accomplishment of what's happening on the stage. And Shakespeare knows these actors, remember. And then what's also even more remarkable then is that a clownish figure comes on. It brings the snake, and the snake is called a worm. It's sort of, you know, typical Jacobean, typical language of the period to call a snake a worm. He says, brings on the worm, and the clown character comes on and starts cracking dirty jokes with Cleopatra. It's really an amazing thing that happens. There's a little comic scene right there, right as she's about to kill herself. And she says, so do you know whether this poison works? I mean, have you seen it? Do you have any testimony of it? And he says, and she says, do you know anyone who's died of it? And the thing you have to recognize is that die and death is a metaphor for, is a euphemism for orgasm. It's a joke that not only Shakespeare, but other playwrights use endlessly in this period. They just never get tired of this joke, although it gets pretty tiresome. And he says, oh, I know of one lady who died of the worm. She makes a very good report of it. That's sort of the tenor of it, right? So they're making all these sexual jokes about the worm. He says a couple times, I wish you all joy of the worm. I wish you all joy of the worm. He says that a couple times. And you can just imagine saying, all right, you know, get off the stage. Let's stop doing. She kind of reassembles herself, and she says to her maiden Ira, she says, give me my robe, put on my crown. I have immortal longings in me. Now no more. And then she says, husband, I come. That's an extraordinary thing. Remember, she calls Antony husband. And she's not Antony's husband. She's the mistress, right? Cleopatra is the femme fatale, the exemplary femme fatale. She says, husband, I come. Now to that name my courage prove my title. I am fire and air. My other elements I leave to baser life. I mean, it's just an extraordinary death. And then she holds the snake up and it kills her. And it's just breathtaking on stage. I mean, if you have an actor who does this right, it's breathtaking. And I think it's breathtaking partly because Shakespeare has completely disarmed us with this goofy little scene. We just don't see this coming. I mean, we're kind of getting ready for it, and then we drop our guard with the goofy scene with the dirty jokes, and then, bam, Cleopatra comes in with this scene that just takes your breath away. I'm fire and air. My other elements I give to baser life. It's fantastic. And that kind of up and down, Shakespeare evidently really knew worked with his audiences. And that's the kind of thing that contemporary recreations of Shakespeare trying to flatten out by cutting out parts. Now, to get to the last section here about adaptation, remember I said that we have to seek Shakespeare in both adaptation and also in the originals, in quotations. And I was just reminding myself of this really great piece in The Onion. Everybody knows The Onion, the satirical piece. This really great piece in The Onion that came out a few years ago, 2007. It's absolutely hilarious. It says, the title is, Unconventional Director Set Shakespeare's Play in Time and Place Shakespeare Intended. And it begins with a quotation. I know when most people hear The Merchant of Venice, they think 1960s Las Vegas, a high-powered Manhattan stock brokerage, or 18th century Georgia slave plantation. But I think it's high time to shake things up a little bit, Hyles said. The great thing about Shakespeare is that the themes in his plays are so universal that they can be adapted to just about any time and place. According to Hyles, everything in the production will be adapted to unconventional setting. Swords will replace guns, ducats will be used instead of the American dollar or Japanese yen, and costumes, such as Shylock's customary pinstriped suit, general's uniform, or nudity, will be replaced by garb of the kind worn by Jewish moneylenders of the Italian Renaissance. Et cetera, so it goes on with a couple more jokes this period, right? So they're making fun of how it seems like modern productions, concept productions, always seem to have to do something very clever with the plays, right? They always have to have some kind of very modern setting, something that will appeal to our sensibilities, something that will allow us to see the political implications or ethical implications of the play. And it's easy to make fun of this, but I think it's a big mistake to make fun of this. In fact, I think that we need to embrace these adaptations, partly because the thing that we could write a satire about, this satire, is that we have no access to a so-called original production. There is no such thing as an original production. Every encounter we have with Shakespeare, that's the strong version, but certainly every production of Shakespeare is an adaptation. It's an adaptation because, well, every time you produce the play indoors with lights, it's a radical adaptation. Shakespeare's plays were designed for an open stage, out of doors, in which the audience is perfectly visible to the actors, in which there's this kind of openness and exchange, which really changes the way you present the roles. We often talk about Shakespeare's roles as being, scholars talk about this as being presentational instead of representational. That is to say, instead of pretending like I'm in a movie and I'm talking to this character and you're just kind of there, watching along, I'm talking to this other character, but really I come out here and I'm talking to you while I'm talking to that character, right? The roles are designed like this. We even see how Shakespeare plays with those rules. I lost my train of thought for a moment. Every time a woman plays a role in a Shakespeare play, it's a radical adaptation. I mean, these plays were written for boys. And it's not that if Shakespeare were alive today, he would want boys playing these roles. But it's also true that if Shakespeare were writing plays these days, you know, all things changed. he wouldn't write these plays as he did because these plays were written knowing that certain actors and certain boys would be preparing those roles. So for example, one part of what's really clever in As You Like It is that you have Rosaline, this wonderful character, this wonderful female character, disguise herself as a boy and follow and meet up with her beloved Orlando in the forest. And then what she does in order to woo him is to say, I tell you what, I will, and Orlando thinks that she's a boy then, right? Because she's dressed herself up as a boy. She's calling herself Sebastian in order to protect herself in the forest. And she says, I'll talk you out of your love. I'll cure you of your love by pretending to be Rosaline, by pretending to be a woman, and I will display all of the fickleness that makes women so unattractive, and you'll fall out of love with her. But what this does is it gives her a chance to spend time with Orlando, right? And so what you have here, it's a very funny play when it's performed now, but it's always played with a woman. Whereas in Shakespeare's case, what he had was a boy actor pretending to be a woman, pretending to be a boy, pretending to be a woman. And it's one thing for a boy to pretend to be a woman if you've got all of the apparatus, right? You've got wigs, you've got dresses, you've got falsies, in some cases maybe you have a mask, you have makeup, you have all of the sort of external stuff, and you can swoosh and all this stuff. With a little bit of an androgynous demeanor, you can really pull that off. But if you are on stage, if you're a boy on stage, dressed as a boy, convincing your audience that you're really the character of a girl, that's tricky. That's where the genius of it lies. And then if you're also a boy pretending to be a boy, pretending to be a boy, pretending to be a girl, that is genius. But there's always a layer that's lost if we have done what we always do. And yet, the solution is not simply for boys to play all of female roles, because we have no convention for that. As soon as you have boys step into all the female roles, we think, whoa, this is a performance that's all male. This is a performance that is kind of radical, it's weird. Our relationship to that is completely different. We can never recreate the relationship that Shakespeare knew those boy actors would have with the audience. You see what I'm saying? So in a real radical sense, every adaptation, every performance is an adaptation. So I think that when we need to embrace these transformations, we need to embrace these adaptations, because to the last point here, every generation creates Shakespeare in its own image. We've seen this over and over again. Just want to give you four quick examples. In the Restoration period in the 17th century, Nahum Tate produced a version of King Lear in which he slightly rewrote the ending so that King Lear and Cordelia both live happily ever after. In the tragedy, of course, Cordelia is hanged, and King Lear brings her body back on stage and then dies of a broken heart with holding her in her arms. But in Nahum Tate's version, there's a happy ending and they can live forever after. And that stayed on the stage until 1838, about 150 years. That was what people thought King Lear was when they went to the theater. That's what King Lear was. And Samuel Johnson, who edited that play, said that he preferred the Nahum Tate version to the original version because the original version was just too heartbreaking, and that a different time thought that that was the better way to write the play. That was how those audiences saw it. In the 18th century, David Garrick has a scene at the end of Romeo and Juliet where Juliet wakes up, and Romeo and she have this sentimental or melodramatic scene that goes on for, I don't know, 150 lines or something before Romeo dies, and then she kills herself. And that stayed on the stage, too, for a good 100 years or so. That was how most people knew the play. In 1699, there's a version, Colley Cibber did this version of Richard III, in which he took lots of bits from other plays. Richard III appears actually in Henry VI, Part 3. And what he does is he stole a bunch of lines from Richard III's speeches in that play and cobbled them together to beef up the line, to beef up the role in Richard III. And that kind of, and he also moved some scenes around and added some characters to kind of make things more intelligible and more palatable to the 17th century audience. And that version stayed on the stage for 150 years or so before they started to change it. And when Laurence Olivier did his famous film version in 1955, he used the same compilation of lines from, slightly adapted, but more or less the same, that Cibber had introduced in 1699, bits from other pieces of plays, to rearrange them in the scenes. So it's very, very recent. And even in the most recent film version of, I don't know, a decade or so ago, with Ian McKellen in this kind of fascist concept version, it's quite interesting. There are a couple lines from that adaptation that are still mixed in. So when I say, like, when we read Shakespeare, much of what we read is not. This is partly what I'm talking about. It's like things have been moved around. It's not actually what you're looking at. And yet I also think that, you know, we have to embrace them. And then let me give one last example. Well, actually, that's enough. No, I have to give this one last example. In the 18th century, actually in 1881, there was this guy named Edward P. Vining, high Victorian author, who was troubled by how, even though Hamlet was so admirable as a character, had such philosophical depth, as a model for manhood, he was kind of wimpy. And this really bothered people, because you ought to have a character like this that you can emulate. And what he did was he said, it's disturbing. And in fact, all of his weaknesses, Vining determined in good Victorian mode, were feminine qualities. And therefore, it was not only the case that Hamlet was weak as having a man with feminine qualities, but in fact, the book is called The Mystery of Hamlet. The truth to the mystery is that Hamlet is actually a woman. There's a secret in the play, and that he sort of somehow, I mean, it's utter madness, of course, it's insanity, but he was trying to figure out, again, sort of recreating Shakespeare in his image, trying to figure out what the explanation could be for this ethical disjunction. And there was a fascinating, sometime I recommend you see this, a fascinating film version done by Asta Nielsen, a silent film actor in the 20s that brings that reading of the play to light. And there she's actually a woman. And in the silent film version, she has a crush on Horatio, and she kind of keeps looking at him sideways. And it's kind of bizarre. So there are all these things. Our notions of Shakespeare and what Shakespeare has been over the ages have been shaped by all of these things. They're not always perfectly apparent, but I think that studying the history of studying the depth and the substance of the lens that we have to look through in order to see what Shakespeare is a good way to come to terms with what our preconceptions are. So I said that we have to seek Shakespeare in both the adaptations and also in the originals. I haven't said anything about the originals. The originals, in some sense, this is the very last thing I'll say, and I'd like to hear what you're thinking. The very reason that we're here is because we're going to have one of the originals right here. We're going to have a copy of the first folio. The Folger Shakespeare Library has lent it to it. I put together, you know, they have this big thing put together for the 400th anniversary of Shakespeare's death in 1616, and they said they'd be willing to give on loan for a month, one of the copies of the first folio, which is a book that's, you know, worth about $5 million. This thing, it's an extraordinarily valuable thing. If you can put together, we'll get one per state. If the hosting institution can put together an application that shows that it's, you know, it won't be wasted and you can take good care of it. So I said, well, I actually have a lot of connections with the Folger. I've worked there. I know people there. I curated an exhibition in the Grand Hall there. In the process, I got to go inside the vault, the super high security vault that has all of the Folger's copies of the first folio. There are about 80 of them, all on one wall, all lying on their sides so you can see their spines. They're not sitting upright because that would be damaging to them, and it's kind of a stunning thing to see. It's they have 80 of what are probably about 240 extant copies of the folio right there in Washington, D.C., all as a result of the collecting mania of Henry Clay Folger, who was the CEO of Standard Oil back at the end of the 19th century, founded this library, bought up sort of very covertly, he bought up a whole block of real estate right across the street from the Library of Congress and right across the street from the Justice Department by having his agents go and like buy one house after another, and managed to secure, with his enormous fortune, secure a whole block there and built this research library as a monument to Shakespeare, and then bought up a lot of these copies himself, and then has, you know, had agents and others working over the, since he died, collecting more. So we have this extraordinary copy here, and it's going back to versions like that, looking at the folio, understanding what that means, and other texts, and I can talk more about the details there, that it's really, really ultimately important to do to break through our preconceptions. So it's partly embracing and being aware of how we're always recreating Shakespeare, and that we ought to be creative and free with it, since we're adapting him anyway. Why not go for it completely? Why not have fun with it? I mean, the texts as we have them are there. We can always go back to them. I think part of how you keep Shakespeare alive is by doing creative things with it. And that cleverness is something that I think we should embrace instead of being overly critical about it, even though, you know, sometimes it's kind of silly and sometimes it's kind of pointless and ridiculous. That's the cost. That's the risk of bringing it alive. So I'll stop here. Thank you for your best attention. It took most of an hour. But we still have plenty of time, I think, to talk, right?
Yes, and I have a microphone.
Okay, super.
If people have questions, it would be great to use it.
Yeah, and questions or comments, right? If you just have things to say or things you're thinking about, that's fine, too. It doesn't have to be a question.
I'll just stand up.
If you use the mic, then everyone will be sure to hear.
I just got a question, both for you and also Professor Meter here.
Yeah.
You take something 400 or 500 years old, and I've been to Shakespeare libraries where you see the original, and on the other side you see the translated.
Yeah.
How did scholars actually ever come up with what he meant to say?
Yeah.
You know, if you see the phrases that we're all familiar with, more of us are familiar with the phrases than the plays themselves.
Yeah.
But, you know, Rose by Any Other Name, you look at what he actually said. I mean, it has nothing to do with Rose by Any Other Name. Who actually determines how it gets translated, both in Proverbs and in something like Shakespeare?
Yeah, well, it's a very interesting question, because, you know, it's editors who do that work. It's editors who make those decisions. And as a result of someone having to intervene to make those decisions, it's more or less safe to say that there are no two editions of Shakespeare that are alike, right? Because every editor has to make decisions, because you just can't read the original. That is to say, your average student, you know, reader can't read the original versions. Nor would you want to, right? Because in some cases we have multiple versions of the text. In the folio preserves 18. Do I hear a dancing opportunity? No, it's just the clock. Sorry. We have 18 of the plays are preserved in the first folio, which was published only 7 years after Shakespeare died in 1623. If those plays hadn't been collected, it's possible that we would have only as many plays as Ben come down to us from Ben Jonson. It's possible we would only have about half of the plays. So and yet, what that suggests, the other side, is that of the 18 plays that did already exist, we have an earlier printed copy. And in many cases, well, actually in all cases, those two copies are different. And part of the question is that editors have to figure out is, why are they different? And in fact, the answer does not seem to be the same in any of the instances. In a number of cases, the version published in 1623 is clearly comes from a manuscript that predates the version that was printed earlier. And so that's very confusing, right? And in some cases, you have a chain of, you know, of texts. And so an editor, for you to read the play and to get all the information out of it, you'd have to sit down with one version, sit down with the other version, and compare the differences and decide for yourself. And so what an editor does is do all that hard work for you, but every time an editor makes a decision, they're turning down one path and not turning down another, which can be very, very interesting. And every time an editor writes an annotation or an explanation in the footnote, they are creating a preconception for you. They're telling you what that should mean, which is preventing you from thinking of something else. And even now, I mean, you'd think after 300 years of really good work on the plays, on editorial work on the plays, beginning, you know, in the early 18th century, when scholars, you know, 100 years after Shakespeare died, really started working on the plays, You'd think that we'd have had everything figured out by now, especially considering how Shakespeare obsessed we are in literary culture. But there are so many things that have not been figured out yet. It's really astonishing. And there, even like in what you think of as a really good, trustworthy edition, like the Norton Anthology, there are so many things that are not footnoted, or that are footnoted imperfectly, incompletely, or incorrectly. In fact, one of the things that I've done as kind of my contribution to the scholarly record is I've published two articles in Shakespeare Quarterly, in both cases drawing attention to how modern, you know, one necessarily as an editor has to draw on the wealth of learning that so many other previous editors have contributed to the project. But one of the things I've done is drawn attention to the problems that general editors, or sort of editors of complete works, or even editors of single plays, don't always have the time to try to figure out for themselves every single problem in the text. And so if you've had people who have answered that question and checked other people's answers for 300 years, you kind of take their word for it. But in some cases, they're just wrong, because the guy who made up that stuff in the 18th century was so convincing that every other person afterward just copied him. And essentially what you're doing is just looking at one person. And so what I've done in those cases is that, you know what, I have a hunch here that this is not right. And I just went from scratch, I just threw everything out, and I figured out that like the actual proper gloss to things that have been incorrect in the glossy tradition. And so, you know, that can be sort of added to the scholarly record. Yeah?
Does every Shakespearean lecturer do that?
No, I mean, it's a particular kind of thing you have to want to do, right? But I find it immensely satisfying, because even though, you know, what I love are the sort of the theoretical and the ethical, you know, parts of reading, the times when moving political things that come up that are part of our lives, you know, I want to talk about those things, like what the plays mean to you. There's something really satisfying about going into the archive and making a discovery, you know, like a real sort of simple positivistic thing and say, damn it, you know, this is right. Or I can argue this really, really convincingly. You know, so there's something there. So that's enough, I guess, to say about that. But yeah, there are, let me just say one last thing, is that I like most, maybe it's just because my mind works that way, I want to see what choice the editors didn't make. I like most the editions that really show you the editorial work, or that have, you know, work in the back, that, you know, lists in the back that allow you to see that. In the case of the Folger Shakespeare Library editions that were that are edited by Barbara Mowat and Paul Werstein, two, you know, really great scholars, they do that. Paul's a textual scholar. Every time he makes an amendment or makes a change in the text, he puts a bracket around it. It's a little bit annoying if you're reading just one clean text, but what it is oh, an editor did something there. And if you want to know what that is, then you can look in the back and see what decision he made. You know, and in some cases, like, you know, in Hamlet, is it, oh, that this too sullied flesh? Or is it, oh, that this too solid flesh? You have two different versions. You've got to choose one or the other. Right? There are a bunch of instances like that. So I'm happy, I would love to, you know, that's my thing, and I would love to talk more about that. But I'm curious to see what other people are thinking. Yes, please.
I was just going to add.
Yeah.
Please
use the mic so everyone can.
The same thing you can, and you know this, of course, you can observe in the various translations which you mentioned. I've looked at 13 Hamlet translations into German over the last 250 years.
Yeah.
And the modern translators, talking about adaptations, the modern translators are trying to avoid some of the proverbs and phrases that we all are so much aware of. They purposely avoid them because they consider them clichés. So you can see a reason why, I tell that to my students,
that
why would someone after 13 translations attempt another Hamlet translation into German?
Yeah.
Well, you do, because the German language changes and the expectations of the audience changes. So, and it's amazing if you just look at, Hamlet's, you know, to be or not to be, those lines, how different those translations are. Even though the first one by Tieck Schlegel was a superb translation, it didn't need to be retranslated.
Yeah.
But 250 years is a long time.
As you know, Schlegel's translation is the one that many German scholars say is better than the original, right?
I wouldn't say that.
It's so good.
But
In one of the Star Wars films, there's a kind of learned joke about that, where the Klingons, you know, they're crazy about Shakespeare, and at one point they say something, to be or not to be. You recognize it as Klingons, like he says, I go, clock, 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 clock. You sort of recognize it. He's saying to be or not to be, and he says, oh, you haven't heard it until you heard it in the original Klingon, right? Yeah. And so like, this idea comes, like, there were some, as you know, some kind of extremely zealous German scholars who almost to the point of imagining that Shakespeare had written it in German, right? Because that was the language that properly accommodated that poetic form. You know, I didn't, let me tell, what else are you thinking? Yes, this man. Thank you for bringing that up, it's wonderful.
I was wondering, you know, you were talking about, started off talking about his, the number of words that he used compared to others, and it wasn't anything special. But Shakespeare does stand out as being so special. And I'm wondering, in your opinion, is it because he was so clever, or because he had to mix cleverness with humor, or was it his understanding of human nature, or could it be that, as some have referenced here, is that he wrote things that seemed to be easily remembered and witty, and for many of us, we know Shakespeare from those sayings, and was that what made him stand out from other writers? There's something about him that, why we're talking about him tonight.
Yeah, now the question is posed very well, and I think what you put your finger on is how it's a mistake to think that the measure of a great writer would be how big his vocabulary is, right? I mean, yeah, maybe a lexicographer would be impressed by that. But in fact, what it shows us is that someone who's really has a big vocabulary, but not the biggest vocabulary, what he does with the words that he does use. What's extraordinary about them? And you know, it's not easy to say, like, well, how is Shakespeare different from other playwrights of the period? But there are a few things you can say. Let me address part of what you said first of all, which is that, you know, I think that so many of these things are memorable. Some of them are clearly memorable because they're memorable in themselves. But what we find memorable now is not necessarily what Shakespeare's audiences found memorable at the time. In fact, what Shakespeare's audiences seem to have found memorable at the time were lines like, oh, woman's heart wrapped in a tiger. No, oh, tiger's heart wrapped in a woman's hide, which is what York says to Elizabeth in Henry VI, Part 1. And that's a line that gets picked up by other writers, partly to make fun of Shakespeare, but in a way, not as a very impressive line that shows great jealousy toward Shakespeare. Another line in Hamlet's speech when he says, you know, what a piece of work is a man's speech. He has this great speech about how exquisite man is as a creation. What a piece of work is a man. And at the very end, he says, I realize in my antihistamine stoked up state right now. But it ends by saying, and yet to me, like the paragon of animals, you know, the paragon of animals, and yet to me, what is this quintessence of dust? Right? And the man is all these extraordinary things. Maybe I can say, how what a piece of work is a man, how noble in reason, how infinite in faculties, in form and reason, how express and admirable. In apprehension, how like an angel. In action, how like an angel. In apprehension, how like a god. The beauty of the world, the paragon of animals, and yet, to me, what is this quintessence of dust? And there's a play in the period where these guys, it's a comedy where these guys come on, they've just been hunting. They have their weapon, they got their rifle, and their ducks. He comes in, he says, hey, you've been hunting, yeah? And he says, yeah. And he says, what's that? And he says, it's a quintessence of ducks. And it's a great laugh line. You laughed at it even now. It's a great laugh line if you remember that line. And so that's a line that clearly stood out, right? The quintessence, to describe humanity as the quintessence of dust. Now, those are lines that we don't know now. We know lines that have as again, my sense of, like, we create Shakespeare in our own image, right? We remember lines that have come down to us by way of other writers who have picked them out in the 18th century and the 19th century and made them more familiar to us. You see what I'm saying? So, yes, Shakespeare had memorable lines, but I think it's still most important that to consider that the lines that are memorable to us now are not memorable because, say, they were memorable at the time, but this larger cultural process of the way Shakespeare's plays have been treated at the center of our educational system. See what I'm saying? Like the mere familiarity of them. Which is not to say that there aren't these extraordinary turns of phrase and the poetry is extraordinary. Shakespeare is different from his, to go back to the another part of the question, Shakespeare is different from his contemporaries partly because, you know, he's extremely experimental at the beginning of his career, and then he gets kind of conservative. And yet that conservatism is what makes him more durable over time. Many playwrights in the period are writing plays that, we often call them city comedies. So they're writing plays that are really written in the language of the period, where there's a really kind of dynamic quality to them. Very, very realistic. And Shakespeare's verse is, especially as he gets older and older, and one of the important things that I might have included as one of my insights is that Shakespeare is not a single author, but he's an artist like any good artist who evolves over time. So you can't think of Shakespeare as one Shakespeare. The early Shakespeare is a really different artist from the late Shakespeare. And so there's almost like four phases in his life, or maybe three phases, depending on how you break it down. I'm also going to say four. And that's really important to think about. But when you get into late Shakespeare, there's this really, really dense metaphoricity, like lots and lots of metaphors together. Whereas other playwrights are writing very, very snappy, very modern dialogue, which you'd think, and probably was thought at the time, the direction of theater. I mean, right? If you thought, I mean, in Shakespeare, other audiences, other writers are doing this, Shakespeare kind of goes back and starts doing these really old-fashioned style romances with this really lofty, dense poetry, while everybody else is writing these really snappy, very modern dialogues. And yet it's really hard for us to understand those because they're written in this Jacobean idiom. Those plays were much more dynamic. They have lots more. There are many, many more references to contemporary cultural events, to places in London, things like that in other plays. They're very alive and dynamic, whereas, I mean, I think it might be too much of a stretch to say, because we can't know for sure, that Shakespeare thought he was writing for a distant future, so he was writing in such a way that, you know, audiences in the future would be able to get the references. I don't think that was the case. I think he was just writing the way he wrote. He was writing what he was good at. So that's one thing. You get this very dynamic quality in his other plays. The other plays are much more rooted in London, and also much more rooted in other parts of the world. There are lots of plays about exotic places in the period. And Shakespeare doesn't really get very exotic. Kind of his notion of exotic is, you know, an island in the Mediterranean or something like that. You know, he doesn't really go far or very far. Shakespeare is also very, very good at creating dramatic situations that have kind of powerful ironies to them. And where you feel as though there's a kind of mirroring or kind of clever structural turn that is very satisfying, is very rewarding at the end, and making it more or less organic, even though a lot of plays have kind of surprise deus ex machina endings. I'll just say that for now. So a few things off the top of my head. Yes, what are you thinking? Yeah.
Well, I was wondering in the actual presentation of the plays,
yeah,
and also in the time period, okay, you have plays and you have poetry. What other literature was there? Was the novel available at that time, or had it not been created yet? Or everybody out there reading sermons?
Yeah.
What else would be in competition to take the audience's attention?
Yeah, well, that's a great question to ask. There's no novel. The novel hasn't been invented yet. I mean, there's a kind of long form fiction that's, you know, like the Unfortunate Traveler, that, you know, you could read. But mostly, what people are reading are romance, capital R romance, And they're reading sonnet sequences of the kind that Shakespeare wrote, and plays. I mean, a lot of people are going to see plays. Plays are extremely popular. You know, we think that, you know, like the Globe Theater could accommodate up to 3,000 people per showing. And there's, you know, it's thought that, you know, something like 20% of the population of London went to see plays on a regular basis. I mean, thousands and thousands of people.
And on those lines, how many times do you think an individual play by Shakespeare had been performed in his lifetime?
Yeah, only a few times, actually. You know, these are repertory theaters, which made their money by getting people to come back to the theater. And so what people, since people, what people wanted to do is to see new plays, they were constantly rotating the plays. So being an actor in this period was extremely demanding. In a week, you'd perform six times, occasionally seven times, but mostly six times a week, and you'd have a different play every week. And, you know, I mean, that was really, really hard to do. I mean, imagine how, especially since the main actors performed all the main roles, you know, so imagine, you know, having to do Hamlet, if you're Richard Burton, you do Hamlet one night and then do Macbeth the next night. And
there'd be written script or they memorize?
Well, Shakespeare would, the playwrights wrote the script down, of course, and then a scribe would copy out each part, each roll. There's little scrolls they would roll up, and that's from the French, the whole, that's where it comes from. Part. They would give you the parts. So you had only your part because, you know, you can't run it off as a Xerox machine. So someone had to, you know, sit down there with a goose quill and cut it off and dip it in ink and copy it out. So you're not going to copy the whole play for you. Not least because you might run out and pirate the play. You might sell it to a printer and make some money on the side, and then where would we be? So we're only going to give you your role. And so what you have is a cue line. This is the last thing that somebody else says, and then your part, and then, you know, then it goes on from there. And so many actors, like, didn't, I mean, it's possible. We don't know much about the rehearsing, but we know that there wasn't a separate director who would do it. The actors, the actors directed themselves, or perhaps one of the actors directed. So Shakespeare was there on the stage every day for his plays, probably acting because he was an actor. Not a terribly good one, it seems, but he's much better at writing. But he was one of the main actors, and we know he acted in other plays. We have records of them, so presumably he acted in his own plays. And he was there to tell everybody what they were supposed to do, but many of them didn't even know what the play was about until they actually performed it, you know? So that's kind of an extraordinary to imagine. But it also means that we have very scant information about what's happening on stage, because Shakespeare didn't need to write that down. Why take the time to write down staging when, in fact, you're going to figure that out once you get up with your guys on stage? And that's partly what I mean by the collaborative process. Sure, they're not helping you write the lines of poetry, but insofar as Shakespeare is creating the final product as this thing in time and space, and also presumably he's not going to work out everything in advance, he has some ideas and then they're going to work it out on the spot, that's really a process. But it is the case. I mean, I told you that we have these early versions in some cases that are printed, and then we have the big first folio that's printed later. Those earlier versions are called quartos, and they're called quartos because it's one big piece of paper that's folded into fours, and it's your quartos. So it's a smaller piece, it's kind of like a trade paperback, whereas a folio, as the name suggests, folded over. It's just one piece of paper folded over. It's kind of 8.5 by 13.5. It's like an 8.5 by 11, a little bit taller, like a legal pad. And those are like big books, like a coffee table book. So the folio is this really grand thing. But these other cheap versions of the plays got printed. Some of the plays got printed. And many of them have what appear to be pirated versions that were reported in some way or another. We're not exactly sure. Some speculations are that in some cases that one or more actors got together and pieced together the play from their parts and sold them. And they're very bad, as you would imagine. And what's really interesting is that you can tell who the pirates are. So for example, in the case of Hamlet, it's pretty clear that Marcellus and what is his name? I can't forget. They're the minor characters, right? The most minor characters. Marcellus and Lucianus? No, that's the name of the character that played with in the play. I can't remember his name. One of the guards, right? They're not main shares. They're not stockholders in the company, so they have nothing to lose. They just make a little money. And they know that it was those two because the speeches of those guys are exactly right, right? Because they memorized them and set them on stage. And the speeches of the characters who are speaking when those guys are on stage are pretty good. But the farther you get from those characters on stage, the worse they get, right? So, actually, I brought this along. I have to quote it because I can never quite get it right. Of course, you know the Hamlet speech is, to be or not to be, that is the question, whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles, and by opposing end them to die, to sleep no more, and by a sleep to say we end the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to, which is a consolation devoutly to be wished. Right? It's the beginning of Hamlet's speech, I'm just reminding you of it. In the first quarto that we have of Hamlet, it begins, to be or not to be, aye, there's the point. To die, to sleep. Is that all? Aye, all. No, to sleep, to dream. Aye, marry, there it goes. And then it goes on from there. Okay, now this is the actual printed version. Now that we know, that is not a good version. That's, you know, obviously been pirated in some way. But what's really interesting about that version is that, okay, those guys got lots of things wrong. But they were there on stage. They saw that. And so they were writing it to be printed, not just right. Shakespeare's writing it to be performed. So when the ghost of King Hamlet reappears in the middle of the play, in what's often called the closet scene in Gertrude's bedroom in her dressing chambers, he appears to Hamlet and warns Hamlet not to torment his mother too much and says, you know, you need to keep going on revenge, kind of, you know, blunts his almost... sharpens his almost blunted purpose, whets his almost blunted purpose, he says. In the text that we know, in the folio text and in the quarto text that was also printed, a reliable version, since Hamlet, we're told that King Hamlet the ghost appears in full armor at the beginning of the play, there's no reason to think that he doesn't appear in full armor when he appears the second time in the play. But in this terrible version, to be or not to be, there's the point. The actors say, enter the ghost in his nightgown. Because they were there. They saw how it was done, and they're just writing it down. Now that is extraordinary, right? So this text that's just completely worthless when it comes to the text itself, when it comes to the language itself, has like valuable bits of information that you can glean from it. So again, like to go back to the question about like how are the decisions made? You want to take information, you have to make judicious decisions about all these things. It's also the case that, there's that bad quarto, and then the company quickly came out, the troupe quickly came out with another one and said, this is the real authorized version of Hamlet, right? Because throw away that old one, this has got all the real lines in it, so they had to quick get out there and make some money before all the money was lost. And that has some, 170, 200 or so lines that are not in the folio. And the folio has some 80 lines that are not in the first quarto version. So when you sit down to read Hamlet, even if you read every single line, or if you go to see a production that includes every single line, and I doubt you'll ever see that because it's always hacked up, what you're looking at is something that was never performed on stage in Shakespeare's time. What you're looking at is a combination of all of the pieces of all the parts of Hamlet put together into this imaginary, perfect construction. So that's another way in which I mean, most of what we look at when we look at Shakespeare is not Shakespeare. It's something else, but it helps us get back at that. Yeah, it's a really good question, really interesting question. I think we go until 7:30, right? I'm sorry, until 8:30. So there might be time for one last comment. Yeah.
I just want a clarification on when we can go see the folio and
It arrives in early February, and I don't remember the exact date. I want to say the 6th, but I'm not sure. But it's all online. You'll find the information there. It's going to be there for the month of February. And we invited Jim, myself invited Jim Shapiro to come. He's an old friend of mine. He's a wonderful man. He's a great scholar. He's really just a delightful man. I strongly urge you to come down for that talk if you really want more Shakespeare. It's going to be wonderful. He's really good at, you know, just kind of bringing everything down and making it real. I admire him a great deal. So I urge you to do that. You know, I did this because it's hard for me since I don't give this kind of talk. I misjudged my time and I wasn't able to talk about examples from a foreign language text, which is our translations, which is why I was happy to have that. So you know that didn't happen tonight. The one thing I did say, and I'll say make my last point is that the last thing I'll say is, you know, I said that, you know, so many of the world reads Shakespeare in another language, and since when translators are trying to translate a text, they first need to figure out what the damn thing means. They need to rely on the footnotes and annotations that editors have written at least as much as everybody else. And what they will do is rely on the footnotes to understand what their meaning is. So what other people are reading out there in those other languages, are the decisions that the particular editor of the copy they're reading decided. And so the translations vary over time, not simply because, say, somebody thought they had a better translation than Schlegel, but because they're using an edition in which editors have solved problems that Schlegel's editions hadn't solved yet. So if you're comparing two translations in the same language, you can't say, oh, well, this is an artistic decision here. You have to look at the originals that they're using, those quote-unquote originals, because they may be different. That is to say, different in the sense that the editors have steered your preconceptions toward one reading instead of another. And what's really, this is the example that I wanted to work through with you, but there's no time for that, is remarkable. It's one of the things I work on, is that in some cases, the translation may actually, because of, say, a mistake, in some cases, the translation may be closer to what Shakespeare wrote, closer to how audiences understood it than your experience as a reader of English is when you read the text. And that's because there's a problem in the text that's appeared as a result of printing errors or something like that, which has solidified as the way we understand it, but which has an editorial explanation which shows that, which explains how Elizabethan audiences would have understood it differently from the way you, as a modern reader of English, will misunderstand that. So when you read it, because of false friends, when you read it, you'll instantly come up with a wrong meaning because the word in modern English does not mean the same thing as it does in early modern English, in Renaissance English. See what I mean? Like the common reader is just going to misread things. And then you look at the footnotes and you say, oh, that's what it means. But the reader of the translation doesn't have to do that. The reader of the translation has the, oh, that's what it means, reading, translated into the text. You see what I'm saying? And so it's odd is that, you know, the first thing I said is that readers of translations are not getting Shakespeare. But in some cases, readers of translations are getting something much closer to the way that early audiences were receiving Shakespeare than you, with your very bad Elizabethan English, right? I mean, you may be native speakers of English, but you're easily fooled by false friends. So it's fascinating to work through those examples and see how that works. But for now, I just have to take my word for it. Right. Thanks, you guys.